2,000 years ago, shepherds rushed to see a miracle.
They traveled from afar to meet a baby.
Their journey was long, but their spirits were vibrant.
They went with haste
because they knew this baby would change the world.
The shepherds were faithful to the message that they had heard from the angels,
that they would find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger.
They're not just an ordinary baby,
but a savior. The Savior.
The Savior of the world.
The Savior of the world.
The King of Angels.
Now in flesh appearing.
And we have traveled here today.
To this room.
To adore that same baby.
Jesus.
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 Though he was born a lowly birth.
In dirt and mud.
We exalt him to his rightful place today.
So come, all of you who are faithful.
So come, all of you who are faithful.
Who have gathered to sing to this baby.
He came 2,000 years ago to Bethlehem.
But we still gather to behold him today.
To worship him.
To worship him. To honor him.
To honor him.
To adore him.
So let us adore.
So let us adore.
So let us adore.
So let us adore our King.
Come.
tidings be, which inspire your heavenly song.
Luke chapter 2, it says, in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house of the lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for him in the inn. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." Amen.
Is my surrender, and here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt, and this is my surrender, and I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do.
Christmas time, Lord, and we remember that you came as a baby. And what do we have to offer? We may not be bringing gifts of incense and myrrh, but we bring our hearts, Lord, to you. We bring ourselves, Lord, we bring our lives, and with that we bring our praise. We bring our dedication. And we say, Lord, that we want you. Because, God, you're so worthy of our praise. And so I just want to take this moment and just ask, Lord, just that your spirit would come and would soften up the parts of our hearts that are blocked, Lord, to you. Places that need you, Lord, would you help us? Because, God, we need your help. Yes, God, we need your help. And so, as a body, right here together, Lord, we're going to sing your praise. Because that's what we can do. We're here. We're here, Lord, to worship you. So we're bringing our praise. And we sing. And Jesus. Say this together. Amen. Amen.
Hey, welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. Really glad that you joined us today. My name is Dave. I'm one of the campus pastors on our Rolling Meadows campus. We'd absolutely love to know, where are you watching from today? Could you let us know? You could tell us in the chat or the comments on the page that you're on. And if this is your first time with us, thanks for coming. We want to offer a very special welcome. We're glad that you're here for worship today. And if you're new, or if you come every week, we want to invite everybody to check in. You can do it right here on this page through the link in the comments or through the Harvest app. And we'd absolutely love to know you're here, and particularly would love to know how we can be praying for you this week. Hey, today we're going to start a two-week Christmas teaching series called Let Every Heart Prepare Him Room. Pastor Tommy Creutz starts the series today. We're going to be in the book of Luke, chapter 1. And to help get our hearts ready, I want to read together. Let's read Luke, chapter 1, starting in verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Man, I can't wait to hear the message today. Hey, this is our last Sunday before Christmas. That is honestly hard to believe. But we want to invite you to include Harvest and a worship service in your celebration of Christmas Eve, wherever you are and whoever you're with. The Christmas Eve service this year will be available on demand, online, all day on Thursday, December 24th. You're not going to want to miss out, guys. There's great Christmas music. There's a message from God's Word. Honestly, there's something for everyone in this service. So make plans to join us. All the details are at harvestnow.info. Well, here at the end of the year, we are super encouraged and blessed to look back and to see the very personal and very practical ways that our church family helped people in need, people inside of our church, and especially people outside of our church family. We wanted to show you that, so let's check out this video together.
2020, what a year. Filled with so much pain, frustration, and sadness, this year was hard, to say the least. But in light of it all, God still moved. God worked through his church, his people. Harvest, in 2020, you stepped up. Despite the circumstances, despite every excuse, you reflected the love of Christ to our city, to our communities, to our state. This year, countless families donated to our food pantries and drive-thrus across Chicagoland. More than 540 volunteers helped serve food to those in need. And 13,203 families received these meals through our efforts. 1,111 backpacks were donated to those who could not afford school supplies. 29 schools received goodie bags and cards from members of our church. Over 115 care packages were delivered to first responders and medical professionals. 337 Thanksgiving meals were delivered to families in need. More than 5,300 meals were provided to the homeless across our state. And 500 meals were served to frontline workers. We partnered with City Refuge Chicago to provide food for those less fortunate on our Chicago's west side. 120 volunteers from our church served over 300 families in need of food and basic necessities. And over the summer, 210 baseball gloves were donated to City Refuge to provide access to healthy outdoor activities. And the best part? Through our efforts in reaching our community, 72 individuals gave their lives to Christ. To God be the glory.
Wow, that is incredible. So much help, so much practical, personal hope. God used you. God used us, the generosity of giving from time and talent, our treasure and our testimony, to be the hands and feet of Jesus this year. And we're believing for even more in the new year. Would you prayerfully consider your giving in these last days of 2020? We want to finish this year strong. Your generous gift to help close out the year will help make more ministry like this and even more possible in 2021. Just want to remind you, there's 4 ways you can give. You can give online, you can give on the Harvest app through a text, or you can mail in your gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. We're trusting the Lord in all of this because he's worthy and he's trustworthy. Let's pray together as we continue. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for Christmas. Thank you for sending Jesus, your son. We put all of our hope in you. We need to hear from you. We need you to lead us. And Lord, we thank you that you have been and always will be faithful. Receive our gifts, Lord, of worship today. In Jesus' name.
Breaking through the silence with glory in the highest, the hope of all creation resting in his mother's arms. A song on the horizon ringing through the heavens, the long-awaited Savior come to set the captives free. Come to set the captives free. Come set us free. Hope has a name, Emmanuel, the light of the world, who broke through the darkness. Oh, hail the King.
People. Thank you that the words that we said we find to be true over and over in our lives. That you are with us. And so now, Jesus, would you speak to us by your Spirit through your word? We pray this in your name. Amen. And all God's people together said, amen. Would you guys take a seat this morning?
Amen. Amen. Well, good morning, Harvest. Good morning. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. We're being joined by all of our campuses right now and our online crew, and welcome to church. So glad that you're here. Anyone excited for Christmas? Anyone? Just a little bit, right? Well, listen, you came on the perfect Sunday because we are starting this week a two-week series on Christmas, and we're calling it Let Every Heart Prepare Him Room. And when I hear the phrase prepare him room, I think about it very literally. Does that happen in your mind too? I think about that phrase very literally, prepare him room. I think about how I would prepare a room, what that would look like. And so maybe you can imagine this, I'm sure you can. Let's imagine this together, right? We've got some guests who are on their way to Christmas at our house. There's so much that needs to be done, right? So many things need to be accomplished for Christmas to happen at our place, in these rooms, in our house. The room needs to be picked up. It needs to be vacuumed, it needs to be dusted, the floors need to be mopped, the pillows need to be fluffed. Oh look, another ornament has fallen off the tree. We're gonna have to pick that up again for the 50th time. The furniture needs to be rearranged. Additional seats needed to be added in our homes. We're gonna break out the fine china, the one time we use it all year, and then we're gonna go put it right back to spend another year in storage. Oh, but look, the young kids have been playing all morning, and like a tornado, they have destroyed all of our progress. Guess we have to start all over again, right? We do a lot to prepare our rooms to get ready to celebrate Christmas with our guests. And this week before Christmas is typically filled with a lot of busyness, isn't it? Are you feeling it right now? Are you feeling the busyness, the stress that comes with this season? Busy getting the house ready for your guests? Busy doing the last minute shopping. I'm looking at you, Mr. and Mrs. Procrastinator. All right, I see you. The Lord sees you. Busy getting groceries. Busy making plans, making schedules for the day. Getting the lights up. There is an increased amount of time that we spend getting prepared for Christmas with our guests. And while all of that is wonderful and great, I wonder, how much time do we spend preparing the external things of Christmas versus how much do we spend preparing the internal things of Christmas? Let's do an inventory real fast. Have you spent more time preparing your house and gifts and lights than you have spent time preparing your hearts? It's a fair question, isn't it? If we're going to say Jesus Christ is the reason for the season, you've seen the bumper stickers, you might have one. He is the reason for the season. And if that is true, and it is, and we believe that, then we should spend time preparing him room, shouldn't we? So, while we're here, the weekend before Christmas, anyone else think it's a little bit crazy that Christmas is this week? It's this week, it's coming. I think it's fitting right now to stop and to examine and prepare our hearts for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in his birth, so that we can, here's the title of the message, celebrate in fullness. So that we can celebrate in fullness. We're gonna be in Luke chapter 1. This week we're gonna be focusing in on preparation that is vital, and that is the preparation of cleaning up and getting rid of some things in our hearts so that we can all the more fully celebrate the birth of our King, Jesus Christ. And so here's the first thing that we need to do. We need to identify the barriers. What is keeping us from celebrating in fullness? What is distracting us? What has my attention drifting away from the celebration of the birth of our King? What are the barriers? What are the things blocking me from celebrating in fullness? What emotions, what feelings in my heart are barriers? We're gonna see a couple of people in the story of Christmas who were dealing with some pretty potent and serious emotions and feelings leading up to the birth of Christ. The first person that we're going to see is Zechariah. And Zechariah is a priest at the temple. Also, spoiler alert, he's John the Baptist's father. And he's married to Elizabeth, and the Bible says that they are advanced in age. They're actually over 60 years old. And so Zechariah, who is a priest, he's on duty during this time, and it is his job now to go into the temple and to burn the incense. And so he walks into the temple, and let's look at verse 11, Luke chapter 1, verse 11. It says, "And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord, standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John.'" That's some pretty crazy news to hear, isn't it? As you're going into the temple and all of a sudden an angel appears and it says that he was afraid. He was dealing with some emotions even right there in that moment. And then this angel drops a bomb on him and his family. You see, Zechariah and Elizabeth were unable to have a child. Elizabeth, the Bible says, was barren, and they were yet to have a kid. And there's a lot of emotions that go into just that right there, isn't there? I know that we have some people in our church who are walking through that very thing, and there are a lot of emotions and feelings that come with just that. But then this angel speaks to them, tells them this miraculous thing is going to happen, and Zechariah is having a little bit of difficulty believing what he's hearing, isn't he? Look at verse 18. Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." I think that Zechariah does a really great job of respecting his wife in this moment. Do you notice how he kind of explains that to the angel? He's like, "I'm old, okay, but my wife is advanced in years." Husbands, I think we can learn a little bit from Zechariah right here, okay? Amen? Way to go, Zechariah. They're over 60 years old. This was unheard of in this time that couples who were over 60 were having children. Can you imagine that? No. This was truly going to be a miracle. Zechariah was having a hard time believing it. Look at verse 20. "And behold, you will be silent and unable to speak until the day that these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time." And so Zechariah, we see, was fearful. He was doubtful. He didn't believe the words that he was hearing. And then he was muted, which I'm sure he probably had some thoughts about, silent thoughts, of course. Had some feelings about that, I'm sure, right? Being muted for a very long time. So we have Zechariah. But we also have someone in the story in Luke 1, Mary, who has some emotions and feelings that she's dealing with. Let's look at verse 26 together. "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, 'Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you.' But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end.' And Mary said to the angel, 'How will this be, since I am a virgin?'" Mary was dealing with some emotions as well. She was fearful, troubled, the Bible says. And then can you imagine the emotions that she's feeling when she gets this news that she is going to be bearing a child? What will Joseph think? What will the people in my life think? I'm not married. There's a lot of emotions that she is probably walking through right now in this moment, and they are difficult. And not just Mary and Zechariah, the people who are in this story, but if we look at the whole Christmas story, we see someone like Joseph. Joseph was having some feelings when he was told that Mary was pregnant, didn't he? He was considering leaving Mary at a time. He was doubtful. He was fearful. He was worried. Then on the kind of opposite end of the spectrum, we have someone like King Herod. We don't talk a lot about King Herod during Christmas time. But he was afraid. He was afraid. He thought that the king of the Jews that was going to be born would threaten his reign. And he was afraid, and he acted pretty terribly. We see all of these hard emotions and feelings leading up to the birth of Christ. Now, your situation is probably a little bit different than the people in the Christmas story. I get that. But you have some emotions. You have some feelings of your own as we walk into this Christmas week. I mean, let's all be honest, right? Life is already hard on its own. Now throw in a year like 2020 and all of the things that have happened this year, and we have a recipe for distraction. We have a recipe for barriers. We have a recipe for a heart that is blocking us from celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ in fullness. And so we need to identify what those things are in our life. That's the first step. What is actually going to keep me from worshiping and celebrating fully? Maybe it's the loss of a family member and the feeling of not being able to see them this year at Christmas. Maybe it's a profound loneliness that you have been feeling this year. Maybe it's the canceling of Christmas plans because of the virus. Maybe it's a broken relationship with someone in your family. Maybe it is the child who walked away from the Lord this year. Maybe it's a loss of a job that has put so much financial strain on you and your family. Maybe it's not being able to even buy gifts this year for the ones that you love and all of the emotions that come with that. Maybe it's the anxiety and the stress that this year has brought and doesn't seem to be going away. Maybe it's the anger that you have at all of the restrictions that are taking place. Maybe it's the worry that you have that the closest people to you are going to get sick. Maybe it's the busyness and the stress that always accompanies holiday seasons already. And maybe it's the frustration because that sin that you thought that you overcame this year has crept its way back into your life. This is a year full of emotions, full of feelings. Do you feel that? Lots of circumstances and situations that are unfortunate and hard. And I know that it is easier to just put our head down, ignore them, and just try and keep chugging forward. Believe me, trust me, I'm a professional bottler of my emotions. Maybe you are too. But we can't do that. We need to identify the things that are blocking us from worshiping the Lord fully. I've been on this new kick lately. I don't want to drink my calories. and so I've been drinking this right here. This is called sparkling ice. Anyone know what this is? It is, can I just say, it's only 5 calories. Not sponsored, by the way, but it is delicious. It is very, for a flavored water with almost 0 calories, it's pretty great. Well, here's the thing, except for this one, okay? This one right here, this is the worst flavor, okay? It's the worst flavor. It's called coconut pineapple. I know that might sound like it would be good. I thought so too, and then until I drank it. And it's pretty terrible. Now listen, if you're in here and you're hearing my voice and you like this flavor, it's okay. My wife and son love it too, but I think that it's awful, okay? And so this bottle of gross sparkling ice is a bit to me like 2020. When I open our fridge or I open our pantry to go and get a drink, I can identify this one pretty easily, okay? Because it is this weird kind of radioactive yellow color. It's pretty easily identifiable, and it's labeled pretty clearly right here. It says gross, coconut pineapple. It is very easy to identify this and to, you know, when my wife and son aren't looking, to throw it in the trash can, right? It's easy to identify, to not grab it, to make sure that I'm not picking up something that I'm going to quickly spit out and throw away. But here's the thing, is we can do that with our hearts as well. We can do that with our hearts as well. Many of us have been through these emotions that we're feeling this year before. Maybe not to the extent that we're feeling them this year, but we have been through this. We know what these things feel like. We know what they taste like. And we can identify them pretty easily. And so we should identify those things that would bring distraction and barriers. But sometimes it's a little bit harder, isn't it? There are some things in our heart that go a little bit deeper. It's not as clear. And so what do we do then? What do we do when it's hard to identify them? Well, we listen when the Lord speaks. We listen when the Lord speaks. You see, in these occasions with Zechariah and Mary and Joseph even, we see an angel of the Lord appears before them, who is a messenger of God. And they came to him and they spoke to them. And they said, do not be afraid. Do not doubt. And then they shared the promises of God that were to follow. Now, you might be thinking, well, yeah, Pastor Tommy, I mean, goodness, if an angel came down and told me, like, I wouldn't have a problem identifying it and then dealing with it and hearing the promises of God. That sounds miraculous, and it is. It is miraculous. But here's the thing. I get that. The angel is a messenger of God. That's a miracle, true. But you and I have access to a miracle as well. It's right here. You're holding it in your hands. It's our Bible. We don't need an angel to come and tell us something because we have the written word of God right here. This is a miracle. It is a miracle. And how many times do we undervalue the miracle that is the word of God? We have the very words of God available to us. God speaking to us through his word. We overlook this and undervalue this so often. Because when we read, when we listen, something amazing happens. The Holy Spirit gives us wisdom. The Holy Spirit convicts our hearts, helps us to identify the things that are happening in our heart. He challenges us. That's what happens when we listen, and we need to be willing to listen to the Lord as we prepare him room. So first step is to identify the barrier, and then this. Clean your room. Clean your room. I felt like I was just talking to my son right there. Did it feel like I was your dad for just a moment? Clean your room, right? We need to clean our room. We prepare by cleaning our hearts, our inward room, removing the distractions, the barriers. And I want this to be like really super clear right now. In no way am I saying that we need to clean ourselves up and present ourselves to God, and only then can we have acceptance or salvation from him. That's not what this is about, okay? There is no way for us to do that. That is actually impossible. We do not clean ourselves up and then go to God and receive salvation. That is works salvation, and we can't do that. We believe in Jesus, and God does the cleaning by grace through faith. So what I'm saying when I say clean your room or clean your heart is not salvific. It is simply the removal of obstacles so that we can worship him more fully as believers, live more fully according to his word and will. It is the process of sanctification in our lives. It is the removal of distraction and barrier. That's what we're talking about. And we see clearly Mary and Joseph, they went through this. They worked this out in their lives, their emotions and their feelings, and they got to a good place. At the end of Luke chapter 1, we actually see Mary singing this wonderful song of praise. It's called the Magnificat in Luke 1, verse 46 through 55. And I would encourage you to read that this week as you're preparing your heart for Christmas. But we also see Zechariah at the end of Luke prophesying. They moved from a place of fear and doubt and worry to a place of increased faith and praise. No doubt that it was hard. I'm sure that it was a struggle. We have to remember, these are people, real people. I'm sure it was hard. I'm sure it was a struggle. But they did the hard work of preparing room, being fully prepared for the coming king. They cleaned their rooms, and they cleaned it fully. I think sometimes when we clean our rooms, we don't always do it fully. Are you like this? When you see something a little bit out of place, you're like, well, maybe that can just go right here under the rug, kick it under there. No one can see it. It's clean, right? Or maybe you, my kids love to do this one. They like to push it underneath the couch. No one will find it there, will they, right? We hide these things in our hearts. When I was in high school, I was cutting weight for wrestling. Wrestlers, you'll know my struggles. And my parents were really strict about my diet and what I could eat. They're like, eat vegetables. I'm like, I'd rather have candy bars, right? And so I would sit on the couch in our living room, which was pushed up against a wall, and I would watch TV, and I would sneak candy bars, and I would eat them. And then with the wrapper, I couldn't throw it away, right? Because if they opened the trash can, they would see, and they would know. And so I would take the wrapper, and I would just push it right down behind the couch. They'll never find that there. I'm in the clear, right? And I would continue to do that. And I did that over a period of months. And then one day, for some reason, they decided that they would move the couch. And there were hundreds of candy wrappers behind the couch. And they're like, Thomas, what is happening? I got in a lot of trouble that day. I got in a lot of trouble. We sometimes do that, though, right? We try to hide, just cover things up, just make it through, not really deal with it. It's still there. We're just trying to make it look nice on the outside. Instead of actually cleaning the room of our hearts, we hide it away so that we don't have to deal with it right now. That's unhelpful. It's actually more hurtful in the long run. When we delay dealing with it now, we're harboring that. We always know that it's there, and it creates even more anxiety and fear and doubt. And when it comes back out, when it is revealed again, you have to deal with the mess itself, and you have to deal with the guilt and the shame about hiding it for so long. And it becomes even worse and even harder to deal with. Me and my wife have had to deal with this this week, this very thing. Many of you know our son has type 1 diabetes, and we had a test for him this week, and it turns out that he also has celiac disease, which is a disease where if he eats gluten, it damages his small intestine. So here we are, walking through another unfavorable diagnosis as a family. And I think that there's a real temptation for our emotions and our feelings to get out of control. God, what are you doing? What are you doing? Like, we just got good with the type 1 thing, and now you're going to make us walk through a whole nother thing. Like, do you hate us? Why are you doing this? Can you just stop? It's easy to go there, isn't it? It's easy for us to emotionally get there. It's also easy to try and hide it. I think that I struggle with this more than Kelly, maybe. I have to be strong as the leader of our household. I'm just going to go like it's no big deal. There's nothing wrong here. We're just going to pretend like I didn't hear that. We're just going to live like we've always lived. But that's obviously not helpful for anyone. And we have had to do the work of preparing our hearts, of working through these emotions and these feelings. God, we know that you're faithful. You're faithful. You've showed us that in abundance over the past couple of years. And this is hard news to get, but we know that you'll use it as a testimony, just like you already have with type 1. So help us, Lord, walk through this purely as a family as we tackle it together. Help us to bring you glory through it. We need to clean our rooms. So let's get super practical. How do we do this? How do we prepare him room? Well, I think about it, again, in the very literal sense of how we would prepare a room in our home. If this room is messy, there are some things that I need to do, right? The first thing is I need to throw some things away. And you have some things in your heart that you need to throw it away. They are not helpful. They are destructive. They are the fear and the anxiety and the doubt and the worry and the trash, the hurtful and destructive relationships, the pattern of sin that developed or continued this year. Throw it away. Put it in the garbage can. Roll it out to the street and never visit it again. I'm going to identify that, and then I'm going to throw it away. That is not helpful for me to be thinking that, to be feeling that. I'm not going to have any part of that feeling, that emotion. It's going in the trash and it's going to the street. And I'm never seeing it again. There are some things that have happened this year in 2020 that you need to throw away into the garbage. There are also some things in 2020 that have happened that you need to put into storage. You need to put it into storage. Some things aren't particularly helpful at all times. And we need to sometimes, in seasons, bring certain things out, right? It is not always helpful to have your Christmas tree out in your living room, is it? No. Can you imagine having to deal with the ornaments all year? Sounds terrible, right? There are things that are unhelpful in certain seasons. And maybe God has brought you through something this year. And it would be unhelpful for you to continue to dwell on the things that took place in that. Maybe it just needs some space. Maybe it needs some separation from you a while. Maybe it needs to sit in storage for just a little bit. But at the right time, you can bring that back out from storage and see all that the Lord has done with it. Maybe you need to put it into storage. Maybe this. Maybe you need to have the yard sale. Maybe you need to have the yard sale. There are some things building up in your heart, in your life. And maybe there is something that God has taught you and brought you through that you need to give away to others. You need to give it away. Don't just keep it to yourself. Don't just hold on to it alone. You have something that can bless someone profoundly. Give it away. Help someone else walk through the difficult season that God walked you through and encourage them and walk with them. Give it away. Have the yard sale. That's how we can prepare a room. Here's the last one. Put it on the mantle. Put it on the mantle. There are some things that God did this year that while they were difficult, while they were hard, while maybe they were extremely unbearable in the moment, in the middle of it and on the other side of it, you saw God work mightily. You saw him do a miracle in your life. You saw him be faithful yet again. And listen to me, that thing deserves the most prominent place in your heart. Put it up on the mantle so that every time you walk past it, every time that you see it, you'll be reminded of the faithfulness of God. You will be reminded of what he has brought you through. Put it on the mantle. Prepare him room. When we clean our room and we prepare it for him, we can then celebrate in fullness the birth of our King. We can worship him fully, which he is deserving of, amen? And not only that, it does something in us as well. It increases our faith. Filled with faith and fully worshiping and celebrating our King. That's how I want Christmas to be. And that's my prayer for you as well. Full of faith, fully celebrating the birth of our King. Amen? Let's look at verse 17 really fast as we close. Look at what it says. And he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just. Here it is. To make ready for the Lord a people prepared. To make ready for the Lord a people prepared. Church, let's be a people prepared. Prepared to celebrate the birth of our King Jesus Christ. Be prepared to celebrate the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord, the Savior of the world. The light of the world has come. Let us prepare him room so that we can celebrate and worship in fullness. And let us be prepared for his coming again. Amen? Let's pray. Father, I pray for every person who is here on our campuses, watching online. 2020 has been a hard year. in so many different ways. There's a lot of emotions, a lot of feelings. And in all of that, Lord, you are good. And we declare the promise. You are good. You are faithful. Lord, help us as we are struggling through some emotions, struggling through feelings. Lord, we want our hearts to be a place prepared for you, prepared for your arrival. We want to celebrate you in fullness, Lord. We don't want this Christmas to be like every other Christmas, busy with stuff. We want it to be full of worship and celebration of you. Lord, help us with this. Help us to throw away, to identify the things that we need to throw away in the garbage. Help us to identify the things that we need to place into storage, to give to other people, and to put on the mantle of our hearts and be reminded time after time after time that you are faithful. Your word is true. We love you, Lord. We celebrate you. We are so looking forward to worshiping and celebrating the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ. Together as a church, Lord, help our hearts prepare him room this week as we get ready for Christmas, Lord. We love you and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to. To do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you. To do whatever you want to. To do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you, yes. To do whatever you.
Wow, what a timely and helpful message. Honestly, there's no time better than Christmas to ensure that your heart and my heart is making room for Christ. Hey, this week, I want to invite you to join us for the Christmas Eve service. It's going to be online, on demand, all day on Thursday, December 24th. And then, of course, next Sunday, we're right back here for worship services on the 27th at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. And let me tell you, in that service, the gospel of Jesus Christ is going to be presented. So be praying with us. And I want to encourage you to ask somebody to join you that you know needs the hope of Jesus. Merry Christmas. You are loved.